Hey, what's going on? It's me, Agostinho, and this is another episode of the Agostinho Zinga Show. This podcast is brought to you by Audible. To claim one free book credit as well as a 30-day free trial, visit audible.com/Aggie. That's audible.com/A-double-G-Y. Audible is the home of audiobooks. If you want to get started with reading, but you can't be bothered to read actual physical books like I do, and you're not that fussed about taking notes and all that sort of jazz, then I definitely recommend you check out Audible, especially if you're a podcast listener. If you're someone that listens to podcasts like I do every single day, every minute of the day, then Audible is the best way for you to also supplement that, you know, audio intake with some knowledge in the shape of audiobooks. The great thing about Audible is that some of the titles are narrated by the authors themselves, so you get a real 3D experience of the book that you're listening to. Maybe sometimes even more than you would do by reading it. I've been a big fan of Audible. I've been using it for years and years and years, especially when I'm going away places or I'm just at home and I can't bother to read, because sometimes, I don't know what it is, but sometimes reading, especially when you're at home and you've got the heater on you and you're lying down on your couch, you get super, super sleepy, right? So sometimes if I don't want to get sleepy and, you know, and end up with a book on my chest with a bunch of spit dribbling down the edges of it, I'll whack on an Audible, plug it into my, connect it to my Bluetooth speaker and listen away. Audible has, like I mentioned before, has over 400,000 titles for you to choose from. But I've picked a couple here that I think would be a good place to start. I definitely recommend you check out Tribe by Sebastian Junger. Sebastian spelled the usual way and Junger spelled J-U-N-G-E-R. Tribe is a great book. It kind of details the kind of history, the kind of societal history of human beings, and kind of pushes this idea that true happiness in some way, shape or form is found by connecting with your local tribe, whether they be people that you work with, people that you live with. And it kind of like details how we've kind of grown up in these small little microcosms, and maybe the troubles that we're finding now in the 21st century, how we're kind of mostly living in overpopulated cities or countries, is due to the fact that we don't have any connections with the people that live to the right and to the left of us. So if you want a bit of an optimistic take on what the future holds and how you can take lessons from the past and apply it for now in order to kind of improve your relationships with your friends and family, definitely check out Tribe by Sebastian Junger. And the next book I recommend you check out, because he's been all over the news lately with the SpaceX shuttle launch and the Tesla Roadster and the Tesla Semi, definitely recommend you check out a kind of autobiographical book by Elon Musk. He does a lot of interviews, but he's notoriously shy about licensing an official autobiography. So for now, this might be the closest we're going to get to an actual official autobiography. It's written by Ashley Vance. It's got loads of accounts from various different people across. It kind of weaves the story of Elon Musk from, you know, from birth until I just think before the latest Tesla came out, right? And it weaves the story through different points of view of different people that worked with him at different stages of his life, from PayPal to whatever company he had in between, to SpaceX, to Tesla, blah, blah, blah. So if you want to get a bit of an inside look into what goes into someone of this level of super genius, I definitely recommend you check out Elon Musk by a lady called Ashley Vance. Ashley spelled A-S-H-L-E-E and Vance spelled V-A-N-C-E. Those are two books I recommend you check out with your free membership and a 30-day free trial and one book credit when you visit audible.com/Aggie. Check out those two books. I definitely think there'll be two books to kind of get you started on the Audible train. And then from there, you can carry on your membership. Oh, and also you can cancel anytime. So this is a trial. Just try it for a couple of days. See how you like it. But I hope you will anyway, because you can use it on Android and your iOS device as well. So definitely recommend you check that out. Now we go to the show. Hello. Welcome to the Agostinho Zinga Show with me, your host, Agostinho, and this is episode 60 of the Agostinho Zinga Show. Glad you could join me, you absolute beauties. How are you? Are you well? Are you okay? Did you have a good weekend? Have you having a good week so far? Great. I'm happy that you're happy. As ever, my week starts whenever it starts. I don't really have Mondays and Tuesdays and shit, as I mentioned previously before. I just love being alive, man. I love it, love it, love it so much. So, yeah, I'm just happy to be alive, man, just kicking and breathing. As you can tell by my level of energy, I've just come back from a 3.25 mile run this morning. So I generally feel quite perky, you know. Came back, had a nice hot shower, then a bit of a cold shower at the end to kind of get my body you know, buzzing and shit. Then I had a nice keto breakfast that contained some scrambled eggs, two bits of bacon and two little sausages. And then I got a little bit of mayo, mixed it with sriracha and put that on the side. So I'm feeling spicy and well nourished, you know. I've got all the grease in me. I'm running on pure fats. That's, you know, I'm going keto for the rest of the week. Running wise, I've been pretty good. Been feeling quite strong, I have to be honest. I've been ramping up the running and not doing so much weight training these last couple of weeks, and I notice that my cardio has improved a little bit more, right? I'm running stronger, I'm running at a more consistent pace. So I can hold an 8:30 mile. Before, I was running the first mile at, like, I don't know, 7:45, second mile 9 something, then third mile 7:59, which isn't good, you know, because it's like, you know, you're just fluctuating too much and you end up like not running strong, your form is all over the place. So being able to hold an 8:30 mile, even though it's slower than the 7:45 that I can do, is better, because eventually I'm gonna be able to hold a 7:30 mile time consistently for 3 miles, which is what I want to kind of get at overall. So that's been pretty good. It goes to show that although you can get training programs that kind of prescribe you to get stronger instead of running more, in general, if you want to get better at the sport that you're doing, you have to just do the sport more often. You know, that's just the basic premise that I've kind of, the kind of realization I've kind of come to over the last couple of months. You have to run more. I was doing a lot more sprint repeats and stuff, like track running style stuff, but I have to... I'm kind of not doing it now at the moment because the place where I was running at before, it's getting a bit crowded. So I have to go there really early in order to kind of make sure it's not crowded. I don't have to keep, you know, it's annoying when you're running on the streets and you have to keep saying excuse me, or running around people, or running on the road, running back. You're just wasting loads of energy. So if I want to do that, then I have to make the commitment to wake up a little bit earlier than I am already. Because I try and get out of my house at like 7:30 to run. But if I want to do what I'm doing at a track run, if I want to do kind of like the whole like track relay running thing, I'd have to get to that area that I run in at about 7:30, you know, kind of an hour before, which is possible, but would mean I'd have to sleep early, which would mean I'd have to be a little bit more methodical with the way that I use my time in the lead up to it. So it's something I'm considering to do. I've got to kind of figure out how I'm going to do it, and I'm going to kind of take it from there, really. But apart from that, it's been a solid week, man. A solid week. Friday was a bit of a blur, you know, as per usual. And I ended up going out with some work colleagues and got absolutely wasted. You know, when you get so wasted and you forget how you get home. Like, I forgot how I got home. I just generally forgot. I had no idea how I got home. I just woke up and I was in my living room covered in a Big Mac. And the brunette had to come along and, you know, put a blanket over me to make sure I didn't freeze my nuts off, which was quite funny. Somehow I managed to get myself a big, you know, that new Big Mac they've got at McDonald's, that XL one. I think it's called Grande or whatever. Well, anyway, they got like a bigger Big Mac now, and I ended up getting that. So somehow I still managed, even though I was wasted out of my nuts, right, I still managed to find a way to sample the new burger in McDonald's, which was hilarious. But yeah, man, that level of drunkenness is just not cool. Just the level of like blackoutness alcohol causes you. But it might have to do a little bit with the fact that I've been, because I've been abstaining for so long. Well, because I abstained during the week, I think my tolerance has decreased. Like, I'm not as good as a drinker as I should be. I don't think I was ever that great at drinking anyway. I think in general, I would generally get tipsy quicker than other people. Like, I take longer to drink my drink, right? I'm a notoriously slow pint drinker. So the slower I'm drinking my drink, the quicker I'm getting drunk. I don't know why. I don't know the science behind it. Don't ask me. I'm not a doctor. But I know for sure I was always the person that took longest to drink. So if I'm not drinking during the week and I'm taking longer to drink in general, and then I end up having an option to drink as much as I like at work, I'm going to get fucking wasted, of course, aren't I? So that's what ended up happening. And last Friday was an absolute blur, man. Absolute blur. But I think it didn't help that I was mixing everything. Like, so at work, on Fridays when we finish, we have a little gathering where we have like little munchies, and sometimes, you know, people will present stuff they're working on, blah, 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 blah. And there'll be, you know, there'll be some bubbly juice to get us all well hydrated and shit. So what I ended up doing was I ended up just drinking everything in sight. And the problem is that we never have ice at work ever. I don't know why we never make that precaution. No one ever buys ice. Like, they always buy good drinks and good section of like little cheeses and meats and shit. But we never have ice. So you're drinking your shit like straight, you know, not non-diluted. You're drinking it like a rapper does, you know, straight out of a bottle. And you're mixing it with like weird shit. Like, I don't know, you're mixing rum and like lemonade and shit like that. So it's just, I don't know, it's just an absolute shit show, right? For someone like me, right? So I'm drinking all that stuff, and then we end up going back to a pub or a bar, and we end up drinking again. And then on the way to the bar, we end up taking a bloody bottle there, and then you end up drinking a bottle on the side of the street, and you're just getting absolutely blasted, man. Blasted, blasted, blasted. So that was not a good, okay, that was not a good representation of who I am as a person. So somehow I end up going home. I'm not sure if I was told to go home or if I decided to go on my own, but regardless, I'm happy I did. So I spent the majority of Saturday recovering, and then going to the gym, obviously, to kind of sweat it out. And then I went again on Sunday, and then I kind of, you know, carried on my week from then, because I didn't really have that much of a hangover afterwards, to be honest. I was okay. I kind of recovered by Sunday. I didn't have a splitting headache, but Jesus Christ, man. Not drinking during the week and then having a blast that session at the end of the week is probably not a good idea. That's why probably it's a good idea to just abstain in general. Like, if you're not going to drink, just don't drink at all. Because when you take that break and you drink once, your body is so, I don't know, man, you're not adapted to it. You end up just getting absolutely blasted of tiny things. And again, don't get me wrong, I did drink the whole bar, you know, like quote unquote, right? Like everything that was in sight, I was drinking a Prosecco, rum, this, that, and the other. So I'm not surprised I got absolutely wobbly, but you know, let's take it a little bit easy. And plus, I need to train as well. So I've been training quite hard. So it'll be a shame to kind of let all the training go to waste just for the sake of a couple of drinks. But it was fun anyway, regardless. I had a lot of fun. So it's good to go out with some colleagues after work and kind of, you know, bond with each other over alcoholic beverages. So that's not something that I will take back. But I think going forward now, because I've got a race coming up in a few months, or in a couple of months anyway. The Berlin Half Marathon in April, so I need to kind of knuckle down and get that sorted. And in general, anyway, I still need to lose a couple kilos in order to kind of make sure that I'm running at my optimum pace. I can run quickly now, but in order to run like effectively, you need to be Slivet or whatever it is, thin or thin. So I need to go back to my previous weight of like, I don't know, 200 pounds. I'm like, what, 225 now? So I kind of need to lose 25 pounds before April. And then I'll be back to my kind of fighting weight, and I'll be able to run a bit faster and probably hold my pace a little bit longer as well. So that's the kind of plan that I'm seeking to do. So maybe take it easy in terms of going out and running wise and all that stuff. Excuse the coughing and shit. It's all this coffee that I'm drinking, probably. I don't know. Maybe it's a coffee. Maybe it's just me. I'm probably phlegmed up. But yeah, so I did that. And then on Sunday, I had the absolute pleasure of going to see Black Panther at the Genesis Cinema. I was super excited to see it, mainly because it just looked amazing from the trailer that I watched. I wasn't that fussed or bothered about the whole idea about it being based in Africa and it being a mainly black cast. It wasn't something that kind of registered in my head at the beginning. After thinking about it, I thought, oh yeah, that's actually quite cool. Actually, if you're a kid growing up now, seeing Black Panther is kind of a good thing. Do you know what I mean? Like growing up and, I don't know, seeing all these rappers that have like colorful dreadlocks and are into listening to Nirvana and shit, and then seeing a superhero movie with a black guy in it, and then seeing something on Netflix called Luke Cage, it's a good thing, right? Now for me, I registered first that it was a cool movie that I wanted to check out, and it was a character that I wasn't really familiar with. So I saw the ticket link go up on Twitter a few weeks ago for the Genesis Cinema, and I kind of just bought it, you know, offhand, didn't think anything of it. I went back a couple of days later and all the showings had sold out. So they basically reserved it for the weekend. They did three, for the Sunday. They did three showings. They did 1, 3, and 7. Or 1, 4, and 7, whatever, right? Three showings and they were completely sold out. And a Genesis Cinema is a fairly big cinema, you know. It's not the biggest, but, you know, it's got ample room to fit everyone in. And they were completely sold out. So I was like, wow, this thing is fucking amazing. It's really popular. I guess everyone's really feeling it. And then when they did the whole premiere, they did the whole, like, kind of world tour thing where all the cast went to all of these different locations around the world. They got standing ovations. Everyone was really happy with it. Good reception, critical acclaim. I thought, okay, this is going to be a really good movie because it seems like everyone is generally, you know, down with it. So I was happy that I bought the ticket. And again, this year, like I mentioned before, I remember I mentioned it at the beginning of the year, actually. I wanted to make this year a year of, like, you know, experiences over material possessions, right? Because I've noticed whenever I'm always the most happiest or fulfilled or whatever it may be when I'm doing a job that isn't intruding in my personal life, right? It's not something that's like taken away from, it's not taken away from what I'm doing in my everyday life, whether it be outside of work, creatively, or whatever it may be, right? And also when I'm doing more things as opposed to buying more things, I always feel more fulfilled. I feel more happy, I feel more connected. So I kind of wanted to make this year the year of like going to events, going to screenings, going to Q&As, going to exhibitions, going on holiday, going to trips, doing running stuff, like experiences over like material possessions, because I can get trapped into the idea of like, oh, I need these track pants, oh, I need that, when I don't really need any of that stuff, do you know what I mean? I can just do without and kind of keep on keeping on. So I was happy that I was able to buy the tickets and take that kind of proactive step. And then when I got there, I was like, fuck, man, like, this movie is big, isn't it? Like, number one, there was a queue outside the door from, like, I don't know, 7:15 onwards, right? Queue waiting to go into the cinema. In the queue, everyone was, like, you know, super, super extra. People dressed up in all the African garb, having fun, dancing and shit, super loud. It's amazing how different an experience going to cinema is depending on what social group or what kind of group you're with, right? So everyone in a queue was super loud. There was loads of girls there, which I was thoroughly, thoroughly impressed with from a visual basis and just generally, right? And I was like, oh, this is interesting, isn't it? Like, I didn't know girls were that into, like, superhero movies in general. Like, don't get me wrong, I know it's been billed as, like, this big black movie or whatever, but I just didn't know girls gave a shit about superhero movies. Then when I started watching the movie, I was like, ah, oh, now I get it, because obviously Black Panther, the main dude, his security detail is all female, right? These bald-headed, amazing sort of, like, you know, warrior bodyguards are like his kind of security detail. So it makes sense, right? And in African societies in general, how I've grown up, which is why I've always found the feminism thing really strange. In my household, or when I used to live in my parents' house, my mum ran the house, like. My dad just slept there. Like, that was the fact. You know what I mean? All the women ran their houses. When it came to organizing trips, wherever it may be, the women are on the sorted it out. The guys just paid for things. You know what I mean? Like, they were literally none the wiser. They could care less. And the women could care less about their opinions. Like, the women run the roost. Like, they were the ones that were keeping an eye on all the kids, making sure people were not fucking around. It was like, you know, yeah, like, I grew up with strong women around my house, so I was familiar with that image, but seeing it on screen, I kind of understood why everyone was, like, freaking out about this movie and taking it, you know, and, like, you know, billing it as, like, an amazing movie, because at this time we're in now, when everyone is politically active and is kind of looking at Hollywood for a sign or some sort of respite in this kind of weird malaise of Me Toos and rights and all this sort of shit, it's good to see a movie that kind of depicts a place in the world where all this stuff that we're talking about now doesn't apply. You know, they don't know what you're talking about. I imagine if you were to go to Nairobi or Botswana or Sierra Leone or Nigeria and speak about Me Too, they'd probably laugh in your face. You know, like, those societies by and large are run by women, right? Or if they're not run by women, they are very aware and they don't really fight the biological differences between men and women. You know, they're not trying to artificially engineer a society where everything is completely fair for both sexes, because that's not how it works, you know. Like, it's not even like, even if you give us equal opportunities, we're still gonna go, we're generally, by and large, people are still generally gonna go the way of, like, you know, the Barbie doll and the truck. Like, it's generally gonna, for the most part, there obviously will be some crossover, there will be some guys that like Barbie, some girls that like trucks, it will happen, right? One or two anomalies, but for the most part, these kind of societal differences or gender differences are important for a thriving society. Like, it works better that way, that women are in charge and make sure the village isn't gonna burn down because guys are not very perceptive and shit, you know what I mean? It's a good thing. So I was very impressed by the movie. I thought it was great. There were some amazing action scenes. I definitely recommend you check it out. The special effects on the movie are fucking insane. There was a lot of humor in it, which I didn't expect, and the humor was on point. So a lot of black jokes that a lot of black people would get and a lot of white people would get, because obviously you know you can't turn your TV without hearing someone saying, oh my god, the difference between da 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 da, you know, so you'll be familiar with those kind of jokes, where they're coming from. And in general, the kind of overarching theme, the kind of, like, you know, the idea that the Black Panther and fucking Killmonger had these different ideas of what it meant to help the world and what it meant to help black people in order to kind of, like, get us back on our feet, blah 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 blah. Killmonger had a more of a quote-unquote Black Panther burn it all down sort of idea. The actual Black Panther had more of a kind of, like, let's go to the UN, more of a political appeal, which is awesome. So I definitely recommend you check that out. And there's a couple of lines in it that really kind of struck home, which I kind of don't want to spoil the movie. But yeah, it's a good movie, man. It's really, really good. It's really, really fun. I mentioned, I think, on social media that a lot of people have... I see a lot of people say, why didn't they make this film sooner, right? Because Black Panther's been around for decades. But I honestly think Black Panther is a better comic book movie now that all the other movies have come out, because they were able to, like, refine the recipe, for lack of a better phrase, right? They're able to kind of, like, get rid of the kinks of the other movie and figure out what kind of works, because I think that's what Pixar does well and all these studios, is that they figure out, okay, what works, what's a great formula for an animation, and you sort of rinse and repeat with different characters and different stories. That's how you kind of get success. But sometimes if you come out the gate with all your good ones, with all your good stories and characters in the beginning, and then you fuck up, you don't get a chance to kind of get back on your feet. So with Black Panther, I think with all the other comic movies that have come out, it gave the people that are making it and the studio executive time to kind of understand what works, what doesn't work, and kind of implement it in that movie. Because it would have been a real shame if Black Panther came out first and it was shit, right? Because we wouldn't get another shot again, right? In general, because, you know, as Ryan Coogler mentioned, or somebody else mentioned, I think that's part of the... Ryan Coogler, I think, is a director. He mentioned that a lot of the reasons why we don't see more blockbuster movies with, like, predominantly black cast or predominantly Asian or predominantly brown, whatever it may be, right, and it's usually the same old white people again and again and again, is that they don't play well internationally, right? Because our international audience is where the movie industry really makes their big bucks. So when it gets shown in China or other Southeast Asian countries or places in South America, that's where they make their real, real money. So sometimes those countries are only familiar with, like, the big blockbuster kind of, like, George Clooney type person. So when they're doing a movie about the Great Wall and they cast Matt Damon, it's not because Matt Damon looks Chinese, it's because Chinese people are familiar with who Matt Damon is. You know, he's a big movie star worldwide. So even if that movie flops in the US, like it, I think it might have done, right, they can tour that, they can kind of show that movie all year round, or maybe for half a year in China or in other places in Asia. So sometimes a lot of the reason why we don't see those movies with a more indigenous cast, let's say, is because, you know, it just won't be received well with an international audience, which obviously you have to think is responsibility of the movie industry, right? They have to take responsibility of that and kind of not educate the consumer, but present a different image, a different profile. Because I was always of the... I was never that really bothered about, you know, there's not many black movies, because I didn't really... I think there was not a lot of black executives or studio producers, whatever they may be, who had the money and the power in order to kind of like make their own movies, right? We got people like Tyler Perry doing it, but you know, those movies are fucking shit, but he's doing his part. So I think for the most part, if you're someone of an ethnic or racial background and you want to see yourselves on cinema, you kind of have to fund it yourselves, right? So I wasn't that really concerned about it, because I think sometimes you have to kind of put up the money and then you can be the boss, like, you know, in terms of like what Dame Dash says, like, if you're not putting up the money, you're not the boss, you're kind of like you're kind of held by the expectation levels of a studio. So they have to kind of like, you know, they'd always have to green light your movie, whatever it may be, or your script. But I also was, the only thing I was annoyed by was sometimes it's like, if you're gonna make a movie based on, I don't know, on Kung Fu and shit, like, have people in it, have the lead character be Asian, you know, like, why would you have some, like, especially, there must be like five top Asian actresses out there who are, you know, who have a good, who have like a good kind of profile around the world, who you could cast as like a lead in like a, I don't know, a fighting movie. There must be, right? It can't just be, you shouldn't be, I don't know, casting Amy Lawrence and Jennifer Aniston and shit in this movie just because you might be able to Asian them up a little bit, or because the amount of people to adjust the audience. I think that's a bit lazy as well in that regard. I think sometimes they pull out those obvious cars like Matt Damon because they know they can, it's something that you can rely on. You know you're going to make your money back. And Matt Damon's, it's sort of like a sure bet, you know? It's sort of like promoting a club night and you keep picking the same old DJs again, because it's like, you know for sure that you're definitely going to get some people to come along, right? Which is okay, but, you know, come on, man. Like, give us a break. So I understand that part of it. But I still think, I'm so happy that they gave this movie a chance. And obviously it's been kind of proved right that they did a good job with it, because it's kind of breaking all blockbuster records, whatever, everyone's going crazy about it. So I'm happy that it's done that, and I'm happy it's just a good decent movie. It's something I definitely consider would watching again, because I was sat a bit high in the cinema, a bit far back, sorry, so I couldn't really see much because obviously my eyesight is fucking shit. So I definitely recommend, I definitely would watch it again just to kind of see some of the fight scenes up close. I think I might have allergies, you know, so I'm coughing so much, whatever. So I definitely recommend seeing it up close again. And yeah, man, it was a good movie. I enjoyed it. I didn't stay for the Q&A, unfortunately, because the movie ended at about, what, like 10 or something? It's like, you know what, fuck this, I want to go home. But the Q&A sounded quite good. There was a guy in there that was doing a Q&A about black superheroes or black icon canon or some shit like that. It got a bit too Afrocentric to me. I had to kind of like, I had to dip. Then I realized that maybe the whole, like, me being against the Afrocentric vibe was based, I thought I was alone, right, in that kind of estimation, whatever, or that kind of point of view or way of thinking. But then I watched the James Baldwin documentary before I left to kind of prep me for the Black Panther, you know, so I was all black powering my weekend out. I watched the James Baldwin documentary called I Am Not Your Nigger, which is amazing. The documentary kind of centers around, obviously, the racial uprising in America during the 60s, you know, that whole thing, just during the kind of Vietnam War. And what it kind of explores is James Baldwin's connection and friendship with Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, and another guy who I forgot the name of, who were kind of instrumental in the kind of black movement within America. And it's an amazing movie because it starts with James Baldwin living in Paris, right? So he's living in France. He leaves America because he wants to kind of like, you know, he wants to get out and explore the world. He's hustling on the streets of Paris, talking to Middle Eastern folk, Arab guys and people from like North Africa and shit, and kind of understanding that this problem that we're having, that they're having in America, is something that can be found elsewhere around the world with different people from different other places around the world too, right? So he's seeing himself in someone from Morocco. He's seeing himself in them, right? Even though they don't look the same. Then he's kind of he feels like he needs to go back because of, you know, these characters like Martin Luther, Malcolm X, and stuff are coming up. And they're kind of taking the mantle and driving things forward in terms of representation of black people in America. And he feels like he has to get his hands dirty and get involved. He can't be sitting on the sidelines commentating. So it's an amazing profile because James Baldwin comes from it at an approach. His approach is, we need Americans, you know, your quote-unquote white people, to understand our pain as black people what we're going through in order to kind of eradicate it. And we need them to kind of like agree that it's a thing, to acknowledge it, and then we can move forward and work together in order to kind of heal the nations and kind of bring everyone together. He doesn't subscribe to the whole Black Panther idea of like burning everything down and taking over America, kind of like, you know, reclaiming the land as per se, or kind of like taking it back as payback for kind of bringing Africans or bringing black people in general from Africa over to America in the first place in chains, which kind of relates back to the villain in Black Panther called Killmonger, right, who's played by Michael B. Jordan. His kind of outlook is that, right, like, you know, he's grown up in Oakland, California. He's seen all the race riots, he's seen police brutality. So his idea, when he finds out about this like mythical place in Africa that has this amazing material that could potentially arm the rest of the black nation in order to kind of take over the world, he wants to burn all the ships, right, in order to kind of take over the land. But James Baldwin is more of a like kind of like, we need to kind of sit down at a table, agree to disagree, and then we can kind of mend the nation, which is what I kind of ascribe to. But, you know, the frustration, the good part of the movie is that his frustration with the lack of acknowledgement that there's actually a problem, right? Because it's funny, because you see footage in the 60s, right, of like people saying, but we have black football players and presenters and movie stars, da, da, da. What's the problem? You need to get over it. And James Baldwin's thing is like, there's these kind of like people in the limelight who kind of represent us there's no direct correlation between seeing an actor on TV who looks like you and a society that accepts you for who you are. There's no like direct correlation between those two things, and that's what James Baldwin's frustration is. And it's funny because we're having the same debate now, isn't it? Because you have these people on TV or whatever it may be, on radio, speaking as if like there is no problem, there is no issue, like we just need to get over it, and slavery is a thing that happened ages ago. But by and large, there is still that fear of the black man, right? That fear that you could at any moment kind of like, you know, break someone's neck or just flip the tables or light shit on fire and stuff, and you know, and take over, which is kind of annoying really if you think about it, especially considering the amount of assimilation we've had to do and we've had to kind of like been forced to do in a land that isn't our own, kind of thing. So I think that kind of alleviated some of my concerns, because I used to kind of think maybe I wasn't, it didn't, some stuff didn't trigger me as the way it should do, like stuff I see in the news sometimes. But then I understood that maybe I'm more along the lines of like, I would prefer it if we all kind of like sat down and spoke about things and kind of worked it out, instead of ascribing to this sort of identity politics, whether it's like Black Lives Matter, all that sort of stuff. You know, I just think it creates more problems. You know, the moment you say Black Lives Matter, someone's gonna say all lives matter, someone will say White Lives Matter. Do you know what I mean? Like, you immediately make people have to choose a team, you know, because it's like when someone says, I want you to denounce X, Y, and Z. Denounce means I have to come on your side. It's like, no, that's just too heavy. Like, people make mistakes, people say shitty things, but denouncing a person because of something shitty they said is just a bit, eh. It's a bit dumb, isn't it? It's just like, you wouldn't break up with you wouldn't stop being a friend with somebody if they made like a lewd joke, would you? Or something, or they were insensitive about something. You wouldn't immediately stop being their friend. You might warn them up several times. You might tell them, hey, don't do that again. If they continually do it and you're upset, then you might stop talking to them. But one or two instances, that doesn't really reflect people in general. And yeah, man, like, it was a great documentary. I recommend you check it out. James Baldwin, I Am Not Your Nigger. Should be available on most, in most places. And hearing him speak, man, it's amazing, isn't it? Like, I'd love to get to that level of command of the English language. You know, he's so efficient with his words. That's what you realize with public intellectuals. They're amazing listeners, number one, because they're always trying to pick up on the nuances or read between the lines or really hone down on what someone's saying. And they're able to explain, they're able to articulate themselves from various vantage points, right? They're able to do that thing where they'll explain something or argue a point without injecting themselves into the situation, which is amazing, because sometimes when you do that, you can be at fault for sounding angry, aggressive, frustrated, or the person can tell you to calm down, whatever it may be, because you're showing more of yourself in that situation or that argument. But these guys are very good at kind of like, you know, it's public intellectuals, are very good at kind of like pulling themselves away from the point and kind of like just speaking about it openly, which is something I've really, really been inspired to kind of work out. Maybe I can get to that level of command of the English language. It's insane, man, hearing James Baldwin speak, like, so, so, so intelligent. Like, it's a shame he's not around nowadays, but what can we do? And then what else I do this week? And then that was about it, wasn't it? Yeah, and then I spend Tuesday and Wednesday, Monday and Tuesday DJing a lot, putting together loads of mixes, different ideas I'm trying to practice on, and just generally reading a lot. I've been reading a lot of this Happiness Hypothesis by Jonathan Haidt, which is an amazing book I definitely recommend you check out. And so far, I've learned from the Happiness Hypothesis that my idea of happiness, which I mentioned before, my kind of idea of fulfillment, I'm kind of going on the right track, because I remember hearing this bit of research that said there is a certain point, I think it's $70,000, whatever that is, right? In pounds, I might be what, like 50,000 pounds. After you earn that, there's no real increase or to your level of happiness, right? So if I was earning 30,000 and someone gave me 50, that's a lot more money each month that I'm going to have, right? So my life will be a lot more, I'll be a lot happier, right? Because I'm earning 50,000, which is 20,000 more, which might work out to about, I don't know, £3,000 more a month, right? Which is an amazing, amazing uptake. But £3,000 a month to 5,000, there is no real difference, right? Like, especially if I maintain my same same standard of living. Like, I still rent a flat in the same price bracket that I was when I was 30. I'm still buying the same amount of things. I'm still going to have the same amount of disposable income. Like, it's not going to make that much difference to me, right? And then what they've noticed is that real happiness comes from your connection with people, your fulfillment in general of, like, you know, what you're doing, and just generally, you know, how you feel. So they notice that by and large, that people that are unhappy are the ones that don't really have that connection with people or with their society or just themselves in general. And it's been a sobering book to read, because sometimes you can get a little bit distracted. You can see shiny objects or people that are quote unquote shiny, and you can sometimes think, like, why can't that be me? I want that too. But then sometimes you look at it and you think, or you kind of have an overarching goal, which is what I kind of have, right? My overarching goal is that I want to be self-sufficient, right? I want to be able to work when I want to work. I want to be able to be location independent, and I want to be able to kind of like do the things that I want to do without having to look at my bank balance, right? It's the whole idea behind it, is that I want to go to a nice restaurant, have a nice glass of wine without having to look at what the bill is, right? Just pay offhand. That's kind of my level of happiness, right? I'll be able to go on holiday whenever I want without having to think about how much the price of tickets are, you know, just book it and go. Like, do like the kind of what Henry Rollins is, he kind of does that, right? Like, what's his fucking band name? Fuck, anyway, it kind of like slips my mind, but Henry Rollins, he's a notorious kind of like traveler and writer or whatever, so he goes around the world. He kind of had a really amazing podcast episode with Joe Rogan, where he mentioned what he does is, like, he'll basically call up his travel agent or the person that books his holidays for him, and he'll basically say, look, I want to go around in this sort of area around this sort of time, book something for me and just give me the ticket, send it to me, and I'll just go, like a one-way ticket, and she'll figure it out and just like book it. So that's the kind of overarching goal that I have, right? So I'm not that worried about, you know, Lamborghinis and mansions and shit. Like, my sense of happiness will come from being able to do the things that I want to do whenever I want to do them. But sometimes as a human being, you can get distracted. You can sometimes look at shiny objects or people within your line of sight and think, oh my God, man, look what they're doing. I want to do something like that. So reading these kind of books is a good way to kind of sober you up and to kind of get you thinking, okay, cool. You might not have what they have, but what you have or the vision that you want to go for is quite good as well. You know, it's an important place that you're kind of going towards. So this is something that I'm kind of wanting to enact in my life in general and kind of make sure that I kind of keep this idea close to my heart and I kind of don't get distracted and I kind of keep my eyes on prize and kind of realize that my kind of ambition or my aim for happiness, it's not better than other people, right? It's not like what they're doing is vain or is bad, but what I'm doing is good too for me, right? And that's the kind of important thing of it. It's like, don't, like, because it happens a lot when you're younger, right? You end up having dreams that other people have because it just looks cooler. Because to figure out what your own dream is that you have to figure out what you can't do. That's what you realize when you get older, right? You have to realize, like, what you want to do is something that you have to, in order to get to what you want to do, you have to realize what you cannot do. And admitting you can't do something is sometimes, it can be quite depressing because you realize you're at the limits. You realize what your own limitations are, right? You're like, oh shit, you're not as awesome as you thought you were, which is, you know, which is neither here or there. But I think sometimes on the road to kind of getting to where you want to get to, realizing that you're not as good as you think you are can sometimes be a bit of a kick in the balls. But it's really important because there are a lot of distractions out there, whether they're good or bad. And sometimes it can be hard to discern what to pay attention to and what not to pay attention to. But what I will definitely implore you to do is, if you're not bothered about reading books or whatever, it's just there's a real good... Actually, not happiness. No, you know what? Grit. There's a book. There's another book I'm reading too called Grit by Andrea Duckworth, right? And she mentioned this amazing thing that Warren Buffett, a little Warren Buffett anecdote that someone said in terms of like goal setting in order to kind of figure out what you want to do, right? And I read this passage that I kind of highlighted that kind of talks about it. So this is from a book called Grit, Why Passion and Resilience Are the Secrets to Success by Andrea Duckworth. And this is the bit that kind of like tells you how to goal plan, how to goal set. Figure out what you want to do. And it reads, Warren Buffett, the self-made multi-billionaire whose personal wealth acquired entirely within his own lifetime is roughly twice the size of Harvard University's endowment, reportedly gave his pilot a simple three-step process for prioritizing. The story goes like this. Buffett turns to his faithful pilot and says that he must have dreams greater than flying Buffett around to where he needs to go. The pilot confesses that yes, he does. And then Buffett takes him through three steps. First, you write down a list of 25 career goals. Second, you do some soul searching and circle the five highest priority goals, just five of them. Third, you take a hard look at the 20 goals you didn't circle. Those are the ones you have to avoid at all costs. They're what distracts you. They eat away your time and energy, taking your eye away from the goals that matter more. Now, it's interesting that you hear that because sometimes you might sit there and think, okay, I definitely don't have 25 career goals, right? But if you're like me and you're, you know, interested in the creative industries or you're entrepreneurial, wherever you might be, right, I can guarantee that you have 25 career goals. Now, there might not be 25 job goals, but they're 25 things that you would like to do, you wouldn't mind doing, you know? A book, a successful TV show, a movie script, there's all these things in your head that you think you can do, right? And I was that person too. But the most important part of it is that it's not a bad thing about having 25 career goals, but they need to be career goals that are aligned, you know, that have some sort of relationship to each other. And there's a bit here that kind of Angela Duckworth expounds upon, where she kind of says that kind of way of goal setting, you know, 25 things, then list the three most important and kind of ignore the rest of them. That's super important. But the other bit that Angela Duckworth mentions as well is another bit you need to kind of like keep an eye on too. Andrea Duckworth writes, so to Buffett's three-step exercise in prioritizing, I would add an additional step. Ask yourself, to what extent do these goals serve a common purpose? The more they are in the same goal hierarchy, important because, no, the more they're part of the same goal hierarchy, important because they can serve the same ultimate concern, the more focused your passion. I repeat that again. The more they're part of the same goal hierarchy, the more focused your passion. If you follow this method of prioritization, will you become a Hall of Famer pitcher or earn more money than anyone else in history? Probably not. But you'll stand a better chance of getting somewhere you care about, a better chance of moving closer to where you want to be. Which is an amazing kind of point to specify, because it's like, I might have three overarching career goals, but they might be in a completely different disciplines that don't serve one common purpose, right? One common goal. But if they have one overarching goal, I don't know, whether it's like creative expression, whether it's like, I don't know, medicine, I don't know, whatever it may be, right? If they all kind of like lead into the same sort of answer or same sort of question, I think it's quite good, you know? But I think that analysis by Warren Buffett is brutal, because when you write down those 25 career goals that you want to do, there'll be things on that list that you really want to fucking do, you know? Things that you're going to be absolutely gutted if you can't achieve. So to kind of like really hone down and be like, you know what? Maybe this and that isn't for me is a hard pill to swallow. So, but then it also makes sense why someone that successful like Warren Buffett would have that way of setting goals, because it kind of lends to how he kind of invests it's like methodical, you know, it's like emotionless, it's like black and white, like what can I do, what are my strengths? And you realize that the older you get, you can only focus on really one or two things, really, you know. When you're young, which is why they say when you're young you should try and do as much as you can, because when you get older you won't be able to do all of it, you know. So it's better to kind of experience as much as you can, get good at loads of different things, and then hone in on one or two that you're going to kind of practice for the rest of your life in general, and kind of, you know, so you end up, you won't end up having to work a day in your life. You end up doing what you want, you want what you like, or what you're passionate about until your day you die, which is kind of like the dream of everyone, isn't it? Like if you're a dancer, like you just want to dance forever, isn't it? Like whether it's teaching or choreography or whatever it may be, you just kind of want to, you want to die on your feet in general, don't you? Right? And the way to do it is to kind of prioritize and kind of like hone in on what makes sense. So if you're a dancer, maybe don't DJ. You know, maybe don't manage a bar, you know, like whatever it may be, like maybe hone into what you actually want to do and then kind of take it from there. So that's something I was very drawn by. And I think these two books lend themselves kind of, you know, are chalk and cheese, you know, not chalk and cheese, sorry. They're very, what would you call them? They're very complementary. So The Grit by Andrea Duckworth and The Happiness Hypothesis by Jonathan Haidt, which I'm kind of tearing through, are two books I definitely recommend you check out, especially if you're a little bit confused, you're trying to set your goals and you're just generally lost in the weeds a little bit, especially now when you're kind of like, you know, you're in February, you might have lost, you might have like broken a few of your January resolutions and you're just like generally a little bit lost and you're a bit wayward. Because I sometimes have those kind of moments, you know, in life. So if you want to kind of get back on your tracks or your rails, definitely recommend you check out Happiness Hypothesis. Jesus Christ. The Happiness Hypothesis by Jonathan Haidt and Grit by Andrew Duckworth. There's something about those two haters that just kind of drives you a bit nuts, isn't it? Oh, God almighty. Yeah, I think that's really about it, man. I've got a few DJ gigs happening in a few months, which are probably not worth bringing up now, but I think the first one is in March, so doing a DJ set on the 26th, I think, the 26th? It's a Saturday in March at the Heathcote and Star, as per usual. So I'm going to be doing that on the 31st of March. So that's Bank Holiday weekend, which should be fun. I'm going to invite my good friends at Pleasures to come down and DJ with me. So that should be a good time. There might be a set in between, you know. I might get the old bat signal to come DJ before that, but that should be good. So I'm making sure that I've got all my dots and my I's and T's dotted and crossed. How do you say that? You say my I's dotted and my T's crossed, or my T's crossed and my I's dotted? I don't know. Whatever you say. Anyway, I'm trying to get things all sorted out before then, which is great. And then I'm going to Berlin next, isn't it? That's my next big trip. So doing the Berlin Half Marathon, which is going to be entertaining. Unfortunately, I've realized the ticket that I bought to go to do the Berlin Half Marathon, it's non-transferable. So I'm going to have to run underneath someone else's name because they don't do transfer. So you can buy someone else's bib, right? So, you know, or maybe you don't know, but when you sign up for a race a few weeks before your race starts, the race organizer, depending on how it is, some races, when you pay for a race, like the Barcelona Half Marathon, there's an option to either send it or collect it at the venue. So if you collect it at the venue, you just bring along your confirmation code, if it may be, or your ID, and then you pick up your pack. Usually it's kind of like done by number. So they have like, I don't know, 1 to 100, 100 to 101 to 200, blah, blah, blah. You queue up, you get your ticket. Or sometimes they'll send it to you. But usually, or in most races, the bib is correlating to you as a person, right? To like your age group, your name, your gender, blah, blah, blah. So I would assume they don't transfer them because it's a bit of a ball ache to transfer it in the back end, right? There's no way of probably doing it. It's just like a one-way printout. Like you sign up, it just prints out your number, prints out your thing. So to kind of go back to the system and change it is a bit shit. And they don't encourage people to buy bibs off people, because if I was to buy a bib off a girl that's like, off a woman that's like 62, but I ran the half marathon in 1:40, you know, it doesn't really make sense, you know. So I get it in that respect, but you know, I don't really give a flying fuck. I'm just gonna run whatever number that I get, and unfortunately the time that I get won't be official because it'll be under someone else's name. But I kind of just want to go to Berlin, have some fun, eat some good food, party, and kind of run. So I'm happy to do that. The flight was all right, only 92 quid or something like that. So I leave on a Friday, come back on a Monday, which is pretty decent, to be fair. So I have time to kind of like sightsee, hang out, race on Sunday, have a bit of an after party on the Sunday, and leave on... No, actually, I leave on Tuesday. Even better, you know? That's even sicker, yeah. Actually, I leave on Tuesday. I don't leave on Monday. It's like Friday to Tuesday. So I get a time to kind of party on the Sunday after, sleep it in on the Monday and kind of come back home, which is amazing. I'm kind of looking forward to that, especially after the last time I went to Berlin was a bit of a shit show. So I'm happy to kind of like maybe fix it up a little bit and reclaim my spot. Kind of and avoid the Berghain, trying to go somewhere else, you know, just have a little bit more fun, a bit more of an authentic experience. This is what I'm looking forward to do. And then after that, it's going to be, we're going to Madrid actually, which is, I'm super excited to go to. I need to get my Spanish down pat, at least my conversational Spanish, and learn that because I haven't been practicing at all. I did a bit of Duolingo the other day, but I need to get back to practicing it every day because I want to get at least conversationally fluent when I get there, because you know the Brunettes family, God bless them, but you know they're not the most fluent English speakers. They don't have to be, you know, they're Spanish, you know, but I should at least have some sort of conversational ability of Spanish, especially since the Brunette is Spanish as well. It's a bit of a shame that I can't speak it even a tiny bit, so I'm definitely going to try and make an effort to do that and kind of get at least conversationally fluent by the time I go to Madrid in May. So those are the first two trips coming up that I'm looking forward to. And then before that, just taking it easy, man. I have seen some stuff that I want to kind of go to and pay for, but I want to save money for my Primavera trip. You know, there's Lovebox coming up, which has Nerd playing, which I promised myself I'd go and see them. So I might have to sacrifice that and kind of like buy the ticket just for the day to go see that. Wireless is probably out of the reckoning now because the ticket sold out a long time ago and they're reselling for a crazy amount. So that's not something I want to kind of do now. And yeah, man, just take it easy, train hard, and kind of, you know, welcome in the beginning of the kind of holiday season, which is always a good time, and see if I can, you know, on the side, try and get this muse up and running and see if I can kind of make myself location and kind of employment independent before the end of the year. That would be fucking awesome, eh? Imagine that, man. I'd be able to launch a business that's successful and bring in a bit of money. That would be fucking sick. So let's see where it goes. Let's see where it goes, man. But yeah, this is episode 60 of Agostinho Zinga Show, man. 6-0. We got there in the end, didn't we? How amazing is that? Episode 60. Oh, the Agostinho Zinga Show, as ever, is brought to you by Audible. To claim one free book credit as well as a 30-day free trial, please visit audible.com/AGGY to claim one free book credit as well as a 30-day free trial, and you can cancel it at any fucking time. So there's no risk, man. No risk, no risk, and all the rewards in life. Once again, this is Agostinho Zinga Show, episode number 60. Thanks for tuning in. Muchas gracias. Adios, amigos.